I love Christmas. The food, the drink, family, friends.
But we all know it's a time when even the most organised people are tested.
Pulling it all off so everyone has a great time, including me, involves using every trick in the book.
So we're here to make sure your Christmas is the best ever. Who better to share her secrets for a stress-free Christmas than the lady with the most festive of names, Mary Berry?
Everybody likes chocolate at Christmas
time. I love chocolate.
She reveals her recipes for the quickest and easiest Christmas canapés and an indulgent chocolate cake that you can make in minutes.
Award-winning drinks expert Kate Goodman has the ultimate Christmas drinks guide.
They offer really good value for money. They're nice alternatives to champagne.
We're looking at Christmas food and drink from every angle. Celebrating the most amazing dishes from Christmas past.
Oh, yes, look at that!
Christmas present at the Ritz Hotel. And a glimpse into the future.
It's almost transcendental, you know?
And we've got some great Christmas advice from the people in the business who really know their onions.
Buy what you need, cook what you need, and then you don't stress about it too much.
Make everything the day before.
Completely prepped.
And just have fun.
Welcome to a very festive food and drink. At Christmas, so much rides on what we eat and drink. We're going to show you not only how to celebrate tradition, but also try something new. With a bit of inspiration and kitchen confidence, I reckon we can all create a feast to delight our friends and family.
Lending me a hand in the kitchen is the wonderful Mary Berry. She's cooked dozens of Christmas dinners in her time and knows how to create a magical Christmas with the minimum of fuss.
So what's Christmas to you then, Mary? What is it with all the little ones?
It's about having a family Christmas, yes.
So how many people do you have around the house then?
Well, we're usually about 12.
We tend to be about 12 to 16 sometimes. It depends if my daughter's around. But then if my daughter's around, she's a chef, so she helps as well, which is good.
I'm all for that. And if people come into the kitchen and they say they want to do things, I get them to do things that I don't like doing. You know, peeling quail's eggs.
Ah, yes.
But I try to do as much as I can ahead of time because I like to be with them.
With so much prep to do in the kitchen, many hands make light work. So Mary's making canapés while I get on with the main course. Mary's canapés are quick, easy and delicious. Herbie cream cheese and spicy mango chutney dough balls.
I am going to go a little bit off the beaten track and prepare some goose.
How exciting. I haven't had goose for years.
You know, I think people are a little bit scared, you know, because they think maybe it's a bit too strong flavour, they don't know how to cook it.
Goose is a great alternative to turkey. It's rich, succulent meat, is packed with flavour, and the crispy skin is to die for.
What are you going to do with it?
Right, well, I'm going to stuff the goose and stuff it in the old-fashioned traditional way, and that's completely stuff the cavity. As opposed to making a stuffing on the side, I'm going to stuff the cavity.
First, I'm making the stuffing for the goose. This will easily feed 10 people. I'm using duck livers and hearts. They're my top tip to add rich and delicious gamey flavour to your stuffing.
They look very tiny to me. I would imagine a duck would have a much bigger heart than that.
They are very small, but they are very delicious. And you know what? The butcher actually gave them to me. He didn't charge them to me because most people don't eat them. And it's such a shame because they're so meaty and delicious.
Well,
and
it's new to me, and so I shall be very interested.
Add the offal to a pan of sweating onion and butter.
Mmm. Now, I'm going to be adding some dried mushrooms to this as well.
Are they porcini ones?
Porcini, yes. Lovely dried porcini. But if you haven't got porcini, you can use other sorts of dried mushrooms. I mean, they're all delicious.
Meanwhile, for Mary's canapés, season a bowl of full-fat cream cheese and add fresh chopped chives and parsley. These couldn't be easier to make. Having sliced the top off the shop-bought dough balls, you just load each half with unctuous cream cheese.
Very, very simple.
Very, very simple. Again, you can do these ahead of time and just pop them in the oven when you want to serve them.
Now, I'm going to flambé this just to get a little bit more flavour in there. So, a generous splash of brandy.
That was generous.
Yeah, well, generous. It's Christmas. You've got to be generous.
I'm going to use some of your brandy later on and something chocolate I'm going to make.
Every stuffing needs a substantial ingredient at its heart. Breadcrumbs are popular, but my secret ingredient is great at soaking up flavour. Rice.
The thing about this rice stuffing inside the goose is that it's going to absorb a lot of the fat as well.
Because it is quite a fatty, and you've trimmed off a bit of fat as
yes.
well, haven't you?
Add to the rice one of my favourite Christmas ingredients, chestnuts. They give a wonderful texture and flavour.
I always use frozen chestnuts, and I always buy them early at Christmas time because they run out. Now, those are cooked. Have you cooked them, or have they come in a vacuum pack?
Vacuum packed. I mean, like you say, you can get them frozen, you can get them vacuum packed, you can get them in tins.
Add some dried cherries.
And that's going to swell up inside the goose, so it's going to give us a lovely sweetness.
And warming winter seasonings. Allspice, nutmeg, and a good pinch of salt and pepper. Mary, who's on canapé duty, tops her festive creations with a dollop of sweet and spicy mango chutney. My festive stuffing is also quick to prepare. Just add the offal to the rice mix and use an egg to bind it all together.
It does seem like a heck of a lot, but the cavity of a goose is actually enormous.
Because the meat in our stuffing is already cooked, it's OK to finish it off in the cavity. But if you're using raw meat stuffing, it's best to cook it separately.
So neck end first?
Yeah, just a little bit down the front bit. I believe that goose is the traditional bird of Christmas. We were roasting geese before we were roasting turkeys. Turkey at Christmas is a relatively new thing.
Yes, when you think of all the Victorian pictures of the geese being driven down the street.
Absolutely. I mean, I very often have game as well for Christmas.
Do you? What sort of game?
I'll have a haunch of venison, sometimes have wild boar. In France, the festivities start on Christmas Eve. We normally feast on Christmas Eve, then we feast on Christmas Day, and then it's my wife's birthday on the 26th on Boxing Day, so we feast again.
I should think you have a lie down on the midday after that. Well, there's one thing I don't do when I'm stuffing birds is get out the needle and string.
Ah.
Because I don't darn socks. So why should I suddenly? Well, I do it with a whole load of skewers and then I can pull them all out.
That's a shame because I was going to ask you.
You weren't, were you?
As if I'd ask Mary to do my sewing. Salt the goose generously to absorb any moisture before roasting. You'll need a large needle and some butcher's string to close up the bird.
That's blanket stitch. You've made a very good job of that. I'll bring my socks along.
This 5-kilo goose needs to cook at 160 degrees for 1 hour 45 minutes, then another 15 minutes at 200. Mary's canapés will be ready in 10 minutes, and I can't wait. Canapés are traditionally served with fizz.
But with so much choice, and the shop's full of special deals, choosing the right bubbly can be a bit daunting.
So drinks expert Kate Goodman is here with a guide to buying the best bubbles.
Nowadays, you don't have to be mega rich to enjoy a glass of fizz because bubbles aren't just about champagne. Here are my top tips for a bit of sparkle.
It's suffered from a poor image in the past.
But you can find some really high-quality carvers now.
It's a full-bodied sparkler and just a little softer than champagne and won't break the bank with a good bottle starting at under a tenner. Most carver comes from Catalonia in Spain. And it makes a great aperitif with a salty canapé.
Crémants are a great value alternative to champagne, but still with bags of French style. They're made in the same way as champagne, just not in champagne.
And they don't command champagne prices. You can get a great bottle for under £15. Try a Crémant de Bourgogne, or equally good, a Crémant d'Alsace.
For a true British Christmas, you can't do better than English sparkling wine. They're made with the traditional champagne grapes, and some are top-notch, even beating champagne in international competitions.
Prices can compare to Champers at around £25 per bottle, but that hasn't stopped sales booming, and the acreage of vineyards in the UK has doubled in the last decade. Maybe that's because the British like taking on the French at their own game.
How do they look?
They look great, Mary.
Whatever your chosen type of bubbles, an exquisite canapé is the perfect accompaniment. And they don't have to be difficult to be delicious.
And they want to be served straight out of the oven, just a few moments to cool so people don't get burnt.
Mary's next canapé uses just four ingredients. Salty Parma ham contrasts perfectly with rich goat's cheese. A few sprigs of rocket adds a touch of pepper, and a slice of pickled cucumber in the centre gives Mary's rolls a surprising crunch.
And you have sort of like little soldiers. Take each one and stand them up, and I think they look pretty smart.
These are wonderful. What a great idea. This is something even the kids can get involved in. I mean, it's very, very easy, simple and fun.
Christmas is a great celebration.
Sounds good, doesn't it? Start the festivities. Aperitif is from the Latin word aperire, so it means to open. So it's all about opening your palate. That's exactly what it's doing. It's refreshing your palate. You don't want anything too sweet, anything too overwhelming. It's just getting your palate ready for your meal. So I love it. I love that anticipation.
We've got that.
Yeah?
We've definitely got that.
God.
How about that?
Brilliant. I love them.
They're beautiful. And as for these, I can't wait to dive in.
Here's the sparkles. It's exciting now. You've got such a huge diversity of sparkling wine, really broad spectrum of price ranges and really broad spectrum of styles as well. So have a go of this.
Christmas
is here. Good, doesn't
Merry
it?
Christmas. Yes.
Merry Christmas.
And this is only the start.
So what you're drinking here is Alini Prosecco Conigliano Valdobbiadene.
I couldn't do that one.
There's absolutely no chance of me saying that.
Anyway, Prosecco, exactly. Okay. Easier to say that. This is from a very clearly defined region in northern Italy, so just north of Venice. This is made from Glera, that's the grape. And with Prosecco, you get these lovely, light, fruit-forward, easy drinking style. That's the key sort of factor here. I get pears when I smell it. And so they're just a really easygoing drink.
Yes, very light.
A very light, good start.
Exactly.
But a very good start
light
indeed.
And fresh.
After you, Mary. Go on. Right. Dive in.
What's your thought?
You get a hit of salt and meatiness from the dried ham.
Yeah, we're liking it. The price on the Prosecco is around the £7 mark. And now we're going up to something a little bit more expensive, and this is around £15. So the second wine is a New World sparkling. This is Jant sparkling wine from Tasmania. And Tasmania's got a lovely cool climate that you need for producing really good sparkling wines. This is made in the same way as champagne and using two of the same grape varieties that are used in champagne as well. There's lots of Chardonnay in this and Pinot Noir. You'll really notice, I think, next to the Prosecco, it's a fuller-bodied style. When you taste it, you'll notice quite a big difference.
It's knocking me back on the nose. It's not very technical, is it?
No, but I know exactly what you mean, sort of going, ooh. I think this is wonderful. You can taste the Chardonnay, the Pinot. It's in there.
I think they offer really good value for money. They're nice alternatives to champagne, the New World Sparkling. So it's a good one to think about if you don't want to break the bank, which the next one does. But hey, it's Christmas Day.
It's Christmas, come on.
So this is champagne.
Right.
And champagne can only come from Champagne, the region in France. And this is lots of Chardonnay in this. So it's a really elegant, beautiful, beautiful champagne. Lots of finesse. I love it. So this is Bilcar Salmon, Brut Reserve. So it's a family-owned champagne house. And that, oh, it's just so lovely on the nose. There's something just so special about champagne. It's kind of magical.
Oh.
We better go easy. This is only Christmas morning. We've got the rest of the day to go.
True. I think that is stunning. But then you're going to be paying.
You are paying a lot more. So the Jantz is 15. This is a big step up. It's 35. So it's a real treat.
The bubbles are quite smooth and they're not aggressive. And it's absolutely, it's honeysuckle. It's wonderful.
So how about having a try of these?
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen so many silent people. Mm-hmm.
Sweet from the chutney, a little bit of spice, and then salty savouriness from the cheese.
That is the perfect canapé, and this just lovely and refreshing because it has got that salty spiciness. Glass of bubbles, perfect. What more could you want?
Mary's made Christmas cooking look easy.
At this time of year, things can get a bit pressured in the kitchen. Some good advice from the best in the business might just save the day.
Things to remember with Christmas, if you're hosting it, is people are coming to your house because they love you.
Make everything the day before.
Completely prepped, just ready to cook.
And in the morning, get up, enjoy your time with the kids.
Be with a family and friend, talking about rubbish.
Ignore everyone that says you have to cook a turkey for 5 hours. You do not.
Make a recipe that you know works.
Offer your services for probably one thing and do it well.
One little tip for the cranberry sauce is grate some fresh horseradish into it.
Make sure you have plenty of wine.
Start drinking early.
Buy what you need, cook what you need, and then you don't stress about it too much.
And just have fun.
If there is no other time of the year you can open a bottle of champagne at 9 a.m, it's Christmas Day and you want to maximise the potential.
Christmas for me is all about teamwork and everybody helping out in the kitchen. What about Brussels sprouts then, Mary? Have you got a particular way to prepare them?
You slightly underdo them. You can do all sorts of things. You could have some nice crispy pieces of bacon fried in a pan. You can put fried chestnuts with them. And also, if you have some left that you haven't cooked, you can make coleslaw of them.
Yes. Another perfect, delicious accompaniment is roasted vegetables. Now, parsnips and carrots as well. And then what I do is get them in the roasting tray and I get some pears. Not peeled, just beautiful pears, bit firm, quarter them and roast them with those vegetables. And that adds a lovely tang. And it's quite a surprise when you're into that. You go, wow, pear.
For me, drink is equally as important as the food. So I spend a lot of time thinking about it and also how to serve it. I really savour it on the day. Mm. If you've got a decanter, it's great to decant it. If not, put it in a jug, just let it breathe. It's the whole process that is equally as rewarding as the food for me.
Do you think of what you're going to eat and then choose the wine?
I was waiting for this one.
Or do you choose the wine and think, right, OK, what's going to go with the wine?
I do always find out what the menu is, but if there's a wine that's really taken my fancy, I'll work it in somehow.
And that's what Christmas is all about, creating the perfect day. These days, we have everything we need to achieve perfection with minimum effort. But Christmas past wasn't like this.
Historian Lucy Worsley has been taking a trip back in time and thinks we have it easy today.
Christmas cards and the Christmas tree and the turkey and even Christmas crackers were all made popular by the Victorians. They lived in an age of buying and selling, so they were very keen on gift-giving, which brought a bit of commercialism into Christmas. But they also made it a cosy occasion, a time to spend time with your family and your friends.
That image was created in part by Charles Dickens and his book A Christmas Carol.
At the heart of the story is the family meal, everybody gathering around the turkey, which must have been very nice in a posh house like this one, at least for the people above stairs who didn't have to do the cooking.
That was the responsibility of the Victorian cook. Most middle-income families would have had one, usually a woman, who worked 12 to 14 hours a day to prepare the Christmas banquet for the people upstairs.
Your typical middle to upper class Victorian Christmas dinner may have consisted of 10 dishes or even 20. It kicks off with stewed eels and cod's head. Mm. The second course is where the meat is. Here we've got roast turkey with sausages and roast ribs of beef. The next course contains pheasants, still savoury, but we've got some sweet food coming in too. Mince pies, I know what they are. But here's a mystery, Nesselrode.
Nesselrode was an iced cream pudding that was a popular Christmas treat in the 19th century. And the food historian Annie Gray knows firsthand how much hard work it was to make. The main ingredients are sugar, thickened cream, candied fruit, and sieved chestnuts, which back then would have been meticulously prepared by hand.
Well, I like chestnuts. I don't like peeling them for the stuffing, though. I did that once and it killed me. My thumb nearly fell off.
You'd hate being down here then when we were preparing this. The first task that normally the scullery maid has got to do
is get those tough skins off.
Yes. Then you've got your nut inside, which is covered with quite a thick skin itself. And then you have to reboil them to get the second skin off. And only at that point do you end up with
these.
I've done that. And as you noted with the chestnuts, you get the bits up your nails, your hands start bleeding, you're peeling and peeling and peeling.
The chestnuts alone took several labour-intensive hours. And once mixed up with the cream and the fruit, the nestle load was set in an elaborate mould for another 8 hours.
That?
Yep. Plate down on the table. Oh, yes, look at that. It's worked.
Why is it called nestle load, then?
It's named after a Russian camp. A lot of it is about showing off your wealth. If you've got a pudding or a cream like this on the table, people know this is a man who can afford a cook. It's the same with lots and lots of Victorian dishes.
Oh, look at that.
The flavours in it are very rich. They're not dissimilar to the flavours of Christmas pudding.
Mmm, it tastes delicious, though.
Mmm.
It tastes way better than it looks. What was Christmas like for Victorian cooks?
Up at 7 in the morning, going to bed at 10:30, 11:30, cooking for that entire period. A lot of cooks died of respiratory failure from leaning over carbon monoxide stoves all the time.
It sounds really horrible and dangerous.
It's all right, you get to swan around upstairs with a glass of champagne.
And of course, if it wasn't for the Victorians and their lust for invention, we wouldn't have many of the tools we use in our kitchens today.
Isn't there a bit of a contradiction here between the Victorians are very inventive, they're coming up with labour-saving devices, and yet they're abusing their kitchen maids?
There is, towards the end of the period, a vogue for inventing mechanical devices. They're not always very good, and it devalues the skill of the cook. So, for example, if I were to use a mechanical whisk, if I, as a cook, can raise a cake just by whisking eggs, that's a skill that I've got, that I can sell, then actually it helps just to keep you in that professional sphere.
So if the domestic drudgery is getting you down this Christmas, spare a thought for the Victorian cook, spending all of those hours sieving chestnuts by hand. I'd rather order chestnut puree online and heat it up in the microwave.
How things have changed over the years and evolved, and thankfully for the better. Take mince pies, for example. It's not that long ago that actually meat was in a mince pie.
Oh.
And these have been made with meat inside.
These mince pies are made from a 19th century recipe by Victorian cook Mrs. Beaton. They look like the modern mince pies, but they have steak and beef suet for a filling.
And it's clam jam full of meat.
Spicy.
Mm. It's a mixture of currants and meat.
It's not quite as sweet as a normal mince pie, but it's delicious.
There's not that much sugar in it at all. Sugar would have been very, very expensive and a real treat, a real luxury. And the spices as well. This is really nice.
Really delicious.
It's good, isn't it? Mm. I think Mrs. Beaton might have got it right.
The history of mince pies goes back as far as medieval times, as does this Yuletide punch wassail.
The smell is good, but it certainly leaves something to be desired on the aesthetics front.
I see what you mean.
Wassail is from the Anglo-Saxon phrase was hail, which means good health. And traditionally it was drunk at New Year, when groups of people would go from house to house and they'd sing wassailing songs. It's made with either cider, ale or mead. They spice it and then they warm it, so obviously it's warm. They often put bits of toast in it, and that just soaks up the liquid, and that's where the phrase to toast someone
toast
comes from.
Yeah.
Oh, let's raise a toast. I think I might let you taste first.
The smell is delicious.
It does smell gorgeous.
But the cloudiness doesn't
it
look
just
too
looks
tempting.
Funny,
it's a bit off-putting, isn't it, visually?
They would call it lamb's wool because of that funny, you know, it looks like wool on the top of the drink.
Shut your eyes and it's delicious.
Mm. I really like the flavour of this. I mean, it's got the sharpness of the apple, the cooking apple, a hint of cinnamon, and almost like a meady kind of ale taste to it. So, no, it's
just the right amount of sugar.
Taste and smell, it smells great, doesn't it? It smells really Christmassy.
Whilst we may not drink wassail today, warm spice cider is back in fashion and can be drunk at Christmas markets and in pubs around the country today.
Food does evolve over the years, but isn't it wonderful that actually some of these recipes stay almost true to their origins, like the mince pie and like this drink?
Mm.
Mm. Well, I'm not keen on the toast on top.
I think I can do without that.
Christmas is all about excess and indulgence for everyone, experts included.
I don't know what you wouldn't eat at Christmas.
I love turkey, I love bread sauce, I love sausages, I love roast potatoes.
I like to eat and drink at Christmas anything that somebody else has made, so I'm not in the kitchen. I like to relax.
My favourite thing to eat at Christmas is probably really, really good smoked salmon.
I can't think of anything I hate to eat at any time of the year.
Everything is good.
I would love some delicious white truffles.
Feed me something I've never tried before and give me something to drink I've never tried before.
I like to be slightly cut.
Drinking pretty much anything.
Nobody likes to drink eggnog.
It's disgusting. Dry, grainy, grey turkey.
Forget about the turkey.
I say cook the goose. Which is exactly what we're doing. And our Christmas goose needs 20 minutes per kilo in the oven, with basting every half hour.
Whatever we eat at Christmas, it should feel like a treat. With so much going on, it's great to have a delicious dish up your sleeve that can be made in advance and served up at any point.
And that's why Michelin-starred chef Glyn Purnell is here. He's got a brilliant Christmas twist on a party classic that can be served hot or cold at any time of day.
Right, Glyn, what are we cooking?
Something you could eat on Christmas Eve or even Boxing Day. But not something too heavy, because obviously you've got the main event. So I decided to go for a pork en croûte, but for those people out there from Birmingham, a posh sausage roll.
Glyn's adding heaps of Christmassy flavour to his pork en croûte. Served with a winter cabbage salad, it's a perfect meal to share. This is no ordinary sausage roll.
A sausage roll is normally served at the Glyn household for Christmas.
We normally do something very similar to this, but with mincemeat as a mince pie. We call it a tear and share, so we just do one great big long one. The kids all get mucked in, and literally they do get mucked in because it's all over the sides. Well, obviously, that's why I do, because I like them to get their hands dirty and really get stuck in.
Sweat down one onion, garlic and smoked streaky bacon.
And we've got ourselves a little bit of Calvados.
Oh, I love Calvados, the apple brandy.
Exactly, and for me, I mean, you smell that, it just says, for me, it just says Christmas, the fire's on, you know. So a little splash of that. And if we can, it's never Christmas without a bit of fire. There we go. It's a good job I got no air. So bring that down. So we're just basically burning off the alcohol.
Yeah, very important to burn off the alcohol, otherwise it would be bitter.
In a bowl of minced pork and sausage meat, add some fresh herbs, four sage leaves and a handful of parsley.
We're just going to dust the ginger.
Add a generous pinch of ground ginger and grate in some nutmeg. For a bit of sparkle, throw in some toasted pistachio nuts and a few handfuls of diced apricots.
The sweetness of the apricot is just that lovely mix, lovely blend.
Once the onion mix is cooled, add it to the meat and now the best bit. Get those hands dirty.
We're going to drop a couple of eggs in there, which you've cracked for me, and then some breadcrumbs, just so that soaks up the fat of the pork.
So the eggs are there really to bind it all together?
Most definitely. When we cut it, it doesn't fall apart.
What's Christmas Eve like in your house, then?
With three children, carnage. Also, we've got two cats and Jack Russell, so it can be pretty wild.
Cats and Jack Russell.
You should never do that.
No.
For everybody out there, don't do that. The three kids is fine. No, to be honest with you, I love Christmas Eve, because for me, they're all excited, the kids are excited. I'm more excited than them, because I'm probably the biggest kid in the house.
Shop-bought puff pastry is a great time saver. I've rolled a whole block to 3 millimetre thick. Shape your meat in a long, thick sausage and place it on one side of the pastry. Then brush a strip with egg wash.
So if you just pick up the meat itself, let it fall, and then just...
And it lands on that lands strip on that, of, yeah. Of egg wash. And the egg wash is going to glue it all together, isn't it?
Yeah, that's our adhesive to any builders out there that want to knock one up. And then we're just going to do a real basic, simple sort of crimp. Just very simple.
But that's a very efficient and pretty crimp.
So that's nice and sealed. You'll probably do something outrageous and like carve a holly on the side of it.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I'm just gonna put a couple of lines through it. And you don't mind having a soggy bottom because obviously it's full of the fat.
Yes.
But the top has to be crispy.
This is one soggy bottom Mary won't object to. Brush the top with egg to give the pastry a nice shine and finish with a grind of black pepper.
You've been a fantastic commie. Would you like to pop that in the oven for me?
Yes, chef.
The sausage roll cooks for 25 minutes in total. 10 minutes at 200 degrees and then...
drop the heat down for about 160, 170 and give it another 15, 20 minutes, depending.
This pork pastry treat is great served straight from the oven with a glass of red wine.
Whatever you're eating at Christmas, choosing the right wine for your main course is often the last thing on your mind. So here's our easy guide to making the best matches.
The most special meals of the year deserve amazing wines to go with them. So here's which wines go best with your Christmas joint. If you're opting for turkey, bear in mind that it's low in fat and mild flavoured, so you'll need a medium-bodied wine that's low in tannins.
For something different, try a spicy red like a Southern Rhone Grenache. It'll hit the spot and go with the cranberry sauce too. Or if you fancy a more classic French match, then try a good quality Beaujolais.
If you prefer white, a rich, full-bodied Chardonnay or a French Viognier will go brilliantly.
And you can find a great value Viognier from the Languedoc for under £10.
Classic reds like claret are great with a rib of beef, which has enough fat to mellow the tannins. Or you could go for a Cabernet Merlot blend from elsewhere. Try the Margaret River region in Australia.
It's worth spending a bit extra on these wines. You can find good quality Bordeaux starting at £8 to £10.
Boxing Day ham with a lovely treacly glaze, my favourite. You could go for a full-bodied beer with a hint of sweetness, like a porter.
For a red option,
look for one with sweet red fruits to echo the sweet glaze. Try an Aussie Shiraz or a Chilean Merlot.
Both countries offer affordable options between £6 and £15.
My top tip, have a full-bodied white and a medium-bodied red on the table and splash out a bit on a good sweet wine to go with dessert. That's sure to keep everyone in the Christmas spirit.
Glyn's versatile sausage roll is cooked and the pastry has risen. The perfect side dish is a tangy winter salad.
Got some pears with a little bit of butter. Here we've got some cabbage, which we've blanched whole on the leaf. We've taken the stalk out and we shredded it, so we're going to drop that in. Would you like to go and get the sausage roll out for me, please?
Sausage roll?
Yeah.
That looks great. Shall I cut it up into equal portions, or...?
Well, you can give me a slightly bigger one, because I've done all the work.
Once the pear and cabbage have sweated down, add half a pomegranate and some of its juice. A squeeze of lime adds a sour edge that will complement the richness of this sausage roll. Slices of pears bring a touch of sweetness and a dollop of chutney completes this perfectly balanced dish.
Right, look at that.
It looks most exciting. Pistachio nuts in it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really filled that pastry, there are no gaps.
It's all about the sausage.
Mmm. Mmm.
It is my sort of food.
Yes, I like that. Just a little hint of ginger, the sweetness from the apricot, that lovely crunch from the pistachios.
There's so much interest in there.
It's a sausage roller coaster.
Oh, nice.
Oh. You've been waiting to get that in, haven't you?
I found it in a cracker.
I mean, you could possibly go white with this dish,
mm-hmm.
but it's quite hearty, it's quite rich, and I just want a red.
Kate's chosen three light red wines to complement the sausage roll without overpowering it.
They're all French, you'll be delighted to hear.
I'm happy.
Big small there.
Yeah, exactly. There's one tick. So the first one is a Beaujolais.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Lovely.
Now, Beaujolais, I think, has that sort of image of confected cherry fruit wine, whereas this is a bit more serious. Chateau Grains Cochard Morgan. And this is one of the Beaujolais Cru. So the Beaujolais Crus are the highest quality level in Beaujolais. The other Beaujolais Crus are things like Fleury, a bit more of a pretty wine,
yeah.
whereas Morgan, it's serious, it's got some punch. It's really sort of dark fruits on the nose.
It's got a little bit of spice as well.
A little bit of spice, a little bit of white pepper. It's more akin to Pinot Noir, really.
Gamay grape.
Yeah, it's the Gamay grape.
Traditionally in France, you would pair up the Beaujolais with charcuterie or salted meat, so I think that's...
The perfect choice.
Yeah, works well. Works well for me.
This one retails around the £12 to £15 mark.
It goes beautifully with this.
Good. OK, right, wine number two. Rhone is just one of my passions. I love Rhone. And it's split very clearly between Northern Rhone and Southern Rhone. So this is Northern Rhone. So this is Cave de Tain Croix Hermitage, and it's all about Syrah here. So that's the grape, Shiraz, Syrah. It's the same grape, just different names. And again, you get a lovely freshness. Lots of red, spicy fruit. Yeah. It's not too heavy. I don't want anything too heavy for this.
No,
I'd like that.
This one's around £10. Okay, and then the last one, which is a Southern Rhone, there's lots of red grape varieties. Mm. So you find a lot more blends in the south. Grenache is one of the key grapes, Syrah, Mourvedre. So this is a blend of all three. This is La Vieille Ferme, which means old farm. Yeah. So have a taste of this. This is really juicy. It's grown on the slopes of Mount Ventoux, hence its name. Mm. So you get a really, not a simple wine, just get that really fruit forward, that really juicy sort of character, lots of red fruits.
And again, quite light as well, isn't it?
Exactly.
Very light.
Yeah. It is light, it's refreshing. It's filling the mouth with lots and lots of different flavours.
Mm. I could blast that down, to be honest with you, without the sausage roll.
That one's around the £7 mark, so that's a little bit cheaper.
Yeah, it's a little bit cheaper.
Well, it's good value.
It's really
good value.
Nice, easy drinking wine.
I think that my family would do quite a lot of drinking.
That's always a good
I think this was really, really good for that £7.
For more information on these wines and all the recipes on today's show, visit our website.
Present-day Christmas can be such a whirlwind of busyness. It's easy to forget that presentation and finishing touches can really add some sparkle to your day.
Writer and performer Arabella Weir is going to a national institution where Christmas celebrations are taken to another level.
I absolutely love Christmas, and this year I want to make it a perfect occasion for my family and friends. Masses of delicious food, fantastic drink, and decorations that look like I've spent £1 million. So I've come here to see how to put on the Ritz.
The Ritz Hotel has symbolised extravagant style and luxury for over 100 years, and at Christmas it's no different. Formal and traditional, no expense is spared when hosting their guests, and boy, did they go to town with their seasonal celebrations. In the private dining room, manager Simon Gerling knows just how to make the mood around the dinner table sparkle.
For me, there are two or three key areas to creating that real magical experience in the hotel. The decorations are absolutely key, and you only have to look around to see the splendour. And then, of course, we have something that's very personal to me, the service.
And are staff allowed to be a little bit more jolly
yes,
with customers?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously a festive period. As long as the service is still slick, it's still tight, and the attention to detail is still there, I'm very happy with that.
And they don't sit on anyone's lap?
Absolutely not.
Golden Crystal is all very well, but you can still create a sense of seasonal theatre without being a millionaire.
Well, this table is absolutely stunning. I mean, just brilliant. How could I do this at home, bearing in mind I don't have a candelabra?
Well, you don't need to have a candelabra. This fruit works very well, and of course it doesn't have to be in crystal, as long as you've got a raised bowl, a nice selection of tangerines and nuts and cranberries. And for me, every Christmas lunch table should have tea lights, especially as most Christmas lunches run through into the evening.
That's really lovely.
And then there's the meal itself. Christmas Day lunch at the Ritz is a six-course gastronomic feast cooked lovingly by a team headed by executive chef John Williams. At up to £305 a head, the menu is as opulent as the decor. There are dishes like turbot with morels and baby leeks, bergamot sorbet, and of course, turkey with chestnut stuffing, topped off with flaming Christmas pud.
How important is the look of the food?
Well, after taste, it's the most important because it stimulates the palate and that will actually get your gastric juices going straight away. So for me, it is very, very important.
OK, how does a non-professional like me make my Christmas lunch look as close to yours as possible?
My motto is cooking is a lot of simple tasks done well. And if you keep that in mind, it suddenly becomes that little bit easier. That's when you get the freshness.
Not doing what my granny in Scotland did, which is to cook all the vegetables the night before and then leave the lids on exactly. So they were all ready for the next day.
That's the perfect thing
That's
not
labour
to
That's labour-saving.
There's a trick to giving your Christmas dinner some five-star glamour, as John's keen to show me. For his lobster starter, he carefully places ingredients to create contrast. Colours are key, like putting bright red beetroot next to fresh green cucumber.
You're doing a specific pattern. So do you have a Polaroid of how to replicate this?
Yes, we do, for the young chefs that are training. Ah. But obviously, myself, I just play with the things.
He also places ingredients with different height, shape and textures next to each other to make it interesting to look at and eat.
Then we have our lobster claw, centre stage.
So it looks like a shark is swimming on your plate.
Perhaps most important of all, the plate isn't overcrowded and white space between the different elements shows through.
Naturally, this is a little bit red, has a hint of green. Where would you think you'd place it?
I'm going to say on that yellow...
That's perfect.
OK.
I'm getting the hang of this.
OK, and that is a bit of ivy.
Nasturtium.
Oh, OK. I'm going to put that one.
Yes.
Just like that?
Wonderful.
Oh, see what I've done there?
It's you marvellous. Have done absolutely...
Can I eat it now?
You certainly can.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, OK.
You might not have the budget of the Ritz or its fancy decorations, but with imagination and attention to detail, there is nothing to stop you giving your Christmas just as much class.
Mary, you've got chocolate in front of you there.
And everybody likes chocolate at Christmas time.
I love chocolate. You see, I don't always associate Christmas with chocolate. For me, Christmas is Christmas pudding. So what are you making?
This is a chocolate velvet torte. It's something to have at any time over Christmas. You make it for Christmas, put it in the freezer, and it's there. And that nice feeling you're organised.
Mary's rich chocolate torte is incredibly simple and doesn't even need baking. It's versatile and keeps in the freezer. Great to have on hand at a busy time of year.
I'm starting off by having a sugar syrup. And I've got here 8 tablespoonfuls of water and 100 grams of sugar. And I'm just going to boil it for a few moments. I've got plain chocolate, so I'm going to put that into the processor. So in goes the chocolate. And I have remembered to put the blade in the bottom and chop it until it's a powder. Then I'm going to pour the syrup through the hole here. I'm going to turn it on, remembering to pop that in the top so it doesn't come out.
Yes.
And turn it on. This is now the most creamy sort of mixture.
Look, silk.
Isn't that like silk? But it's hot. And at this stage, I'm going to add the egg yolks.
2 tablespoons of your favourite Christmas spirit will give this torte a wonderful festive zing.
And that's nearly done.
Are you a fan of Christmas pudding?
I like Christmas pudding a lot. I always serve it with brandy cream rather than brandy butter.
See, I like custard.
Oh, do you? One thing I do, I don't know about in your house, we don't eat all the Christmas pudding on Christmas Day. Mm. So what I do is line a bowl smaller than the original pudding basin with cling film, and then I push the Christmas pudding into that.
Back into it.
Back into it. And it reshapes into a Christmas pudding. And you can have it maybe the next weekend and you turn it out and it looks just like a...
And nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
Fold the melted chocolate mix into double cream that's been well whisked.
It's quite easy to know how well it's mixed in because you won't get any streaks in it.
That's it, isn't it? That's when to stop.
Grease and line a 20-centimetre loose-bottomed cake tin with cling film. Or you can use a shallow dish that's safe to freeze.
And then it's just a matter of levelling it off.
The great thing about this torte is that it doesn't take up valuable space in the fridge. Just leave it to set in the freezer for at least 4 hours while you concentrate on the star of the show.
The goose is cooked. It has had its allotted time. Look at that.
What a shine on it. lovely. Oh, look at all that fat.
All that lovely fat we're going to use for our roast potatoes.
It's clear as clear, isn't it?
Look at that. Isn't that beautiful?
And I suppose you can drain all that off and keep it in a jar in the fridge for every time you have roast potatoes.
Heat the goose fat in a roasting pan until it's smoking hot.
I think that's the secret to a good roast potato, isn't it?
Absolutely.
High heat.
Have you pre-boiled your potatoes?
Pre-boiled. They're just slightly underdone. And then in the colander, let the steam escape and give them a good shake.
Add the potatoes, and my tip to get the crunch we crave is don't shake the pan.
Just leave them in there for a minute or so as they start to colour.
And also, they will get a skin on the bottom, and then you free them.
Exactly.
While the potatoes are colouring, cover the goose in foil so it can rest.
And it's amazing how long a bird stays hot.
And this will keep very hot because of the stuffing inside.
Then blast the potatoes on a high heat so they get wonderful crunchy edges roasting in the goose fat.
For me, Christmas is all about the food and drink. But what's on everyone else's wish list?
For Christmas this year, I would like somebody else to organise the whole thing.
So give me a nice panettone and hallelujah.
Oh, what would I like for my Christmas present this year? A long summer holiday.
Contributions to my favourite charities.
I always ask for the same thing every year, an Aston Martin DB5.
I might as well give my wife the wish list.
I don't even like cars, I just love Aston Martins.
A nice small sailing boat.
Kind arts and coronets. I think after a big lunch you should all sit on the sofas and watch a black and white film.
So if you win the lottery, darling, you know what I'd like?
This year, all I want for Christmas is to be able to get home to New Zealand with my friends and family.
The absolute only thing I want for Christmas is kisses and cuddles from my wife and my two little girls.
Can you make that come true?
Let's hope our experts have been well behaved and they get what's on their wish list. There are some fantastically weird and wonderful food and drink gifts out there for the gourmet who has everything.
Any guesses, Glyn? Any idea?
A sleeping bag for my Jack Russell.
Could do, it could work.
It could,
not
yeah.
far off. This is called an insulator bag. So this is like an eco-friendly slow cooker. So you start cooking your food on the hob, get it really hot, nice and boiling, then open this up, okay. In it goes, top on, lid on, tie it up nice and tightly, and it'll keep cooking for 6 hours. What's this one anyway? This looks like a breath freshener or something.
Oh, no. Well, yeah, I suppose it could double up as that as well. I mean, I've actually got one of these at home.
It's something to do with getting juice out of citrus fruit.
Yes, yep. Indeed. Oh. In it goes.
And yeah.
Then you can.
Oh, yeah.
And then you've got your...
Oh, that's quite cunning.
That's cool.
That is good, yeah. Actually.
So you just spray your lemon.
This one, I think, is a bit sort of...
That looks scary.
We use one in my kitchen, and I'm supposed to use one in yours.
Do you use it with a white radish? Doesn't it do a spiral?
Whirly wheel, and you get lovely spaghetti.
It's spaghetti. Do you know, I thought it was slices.
No. Well, you can do the slices as well.
Yeah, slices as well.
I'd like that for salad, wouldn't you?
Any ideas about this red thing? It's odd.
I really haven't got a clue. There's an egg sitting over there.
Yes, I think it's anything to do with the egg. I think that gives it away, really, doesn't it?
To take the white out of the egg.
Is it to take the white
out of
the
yolk?
No, the yolk would break.
Would it?
I'm not taking the responsibility. I think senior chef should take it on.
Here we go. You squeeze, and you get the vacuum, and you let go.
Oh!
No, I don't like being defeated. We'll have another go. Actually, no. You know what? We're not going to have another go. You're going to have a go. Okay. Oh, yeah. The pressure's on. But let's give it a chance.
Go on, have a go. The tension is mounting.
Oh, nice technique.
Oh, chef.
Nice technique.
The cat that got the cream.
Gift-giving is always a highlight, but for me, it's Christmas dinner that's the magical moment of the day.
We're roasting goose, and many of you will be roasting turkey. But what's the roast of Christmas future? Stefan Gates has been gazing into his crystal ball and suspects that there are some surprises in store.
many of us, Christmas Day is the most traditional time of the year. The hats, the crackers, the turkey so dry it squeaks on your teeth. Now, if that's your bag, absolutely fine, have a blast. But for me, food has to be an adventure, and I reckon that the traditional turkey dinner is ripe for reinvention to take it into the future. Chef Ross Clark has worked for Heston Blumenthal and shares his obsession for recipe reinvention and future food. What do you think will be the Christmas dinner of the future?
I think that we'll still have turkey, as it's so traditional.
So we'll stick with the base ingredient.
Yeah.
Millions of people sighing across the country going, exactly. He's not going to take the turkey away.
It's sustainable, it's cheap, it's still a great cut of meat.
But to take the turkey dinner into the future, Ross uses a combination of amazing high-tech kit and traditional processes to create turkey two ways.
So what are you going to do to it to make it more interesting? We're just going to take more modern techniques that we use in fine dining kitchens, things like brining, and then the way we cook it. We're not going to put it in an oven and just nail it.
To get the best out of the turkey, Ross treats the dark meat and light meat differently. He's confit the breast in butter to stop it drying out, and it's cooked for 7 hours in a precisely controlled water bath.
You see there, all the juices that have come out are still sitting around the breast itself, so it's cooking in those juices as well.
It looks slightly obscene, but that's all really good news, isn't it?
It's all flavour.
But he's brined the dark meat in salt water with coffee and caraway.
My gosh, that's like the primordial soup in there.
Brining hydrates the meat before cooking, helping it stay as moist as possible. Once the turkey's steeped for 3 hours, it goes into a bag to be vacuum sealed. This is the first part of the sous vide cooking method.
What it's doing now is sucking all the air out, and sous vide means under pressure, so we're just really squeezing it tight so the moisture can't go anywhere.
This process will make dried out turkey a thing of the past.
You can see there, the turkey's now no air inside there at all.
Something kind of beautiful about that, isn't there? The sous vide method involves a slow and low temperature cook in a water bath. More than just boil in the bag, this technique promises tender, juicy meat every time.
It's not getting really hot, but it's still... It's not, it's just tickling away its own juices.
The coffee and caraway flavours are reintroduced to the leg in a melted butter. And Ross uses a home smoke gun to fire in the aroma of apple chips. It's a unique piece of kit that can smoke anything from prawns to potatoes. High-tech cling film still required. This kit started life in high-end kitchens, but like most technology, it's finding its way to the domestic market. You never know, it could be as popular as the microwave in years to come. Ross has one final trick, blowtorching the breast to get the crispy skin everyone loves.
Smoked turkey leg. That is quite mind-blowing. Very complex, a whole range of different flavours there, but the moistness of this fella is absolutely extraordinary.
Brilliant.
The breast, I think, is the one that... If this works, then I'm a buyer. I can't hear any squeaking. It's almost transcendental. It's a food that you know and you love as being something as so important to have on Christmas Day, but this time, it's genuinely fantastic. Thank you very much.
So now my futuristic turkey just needs a suitably cutting-edge cocktail to bring this feast bang up to date.
Wow.
Thomas Ask is at the forefront of the cocktail scene, and he's reinvented a 19th century drink, the Sazerac, for Christmas in the 21st century. He blends mince pie, cognac, and cream and distills them with a rotary evaporator to get a clear mince pie infused cognac. He adds sweet sherry and Peychaud bitters and he serves it with atomized absinthe and a tobacco fog to ignite the senses.
Wow. It's absolutely amazing because all of these tastes and flavors inside here are very familiar, they're very traditional, and yet it's a drink that is wildly adventurous. And if this is the future of Christmas dinner, bring it on.
Our festive feast is nearly ready.
Mary's frozen tort has been decorated with grated chocolate, strawberries, and dusted with icing sugar. Once it's thawed for 20 minutes, this cake will be the ultimate finale to a fabulous feast.
Look at that. That gravy smells all right. Bit of Madeira in there.
Beautiful little splash of Madeira. All the juice is going in there.
Here he goes.
OK, let's do it.
Yo! Hey, look at that!
Oh, wow.
Fantastic.
Amazing.
It smells wonderful, doesn't it?
It smells absolutely amazing.
The aroma is just unbelievable.
Heavenly roast goose, cooked to perfection. The crispy skin surrounds succulent, juicy meat that will fall off the bone. And no Christmas dinner is complete without all the trimmings. Crunchy roast potatoes and roasted veg with pear. Brussels sprouts with crumbled chestnuts and red currants. And, of course, pigs in blankets.
Whoa, there we go.
Look at that. Doesn't that look beautiful?
We've got the stuffing there and that lovely meat. Mm-hmm. And it's important to get some nice crispy skin on every slice because that is just like...
It's taken on a lovely colour, your stuffing.
All the juices have soaked into the rice.
Yes, it's gone much darker. It looks wonderful.
That's serious.
Our perfect Christmas meal is a modern take on the traditional. With our tips, this first-class Christmas dinner can break the mould without breaking your Christmas spirit.
Now, this is a proper Christmas dinner. You know, you see no white, but just a ring. This is what this is all about.
The only thing we're missing is a drink that can match the complexity of this mouth-watering meal.
You gonna do the honours?
No. I've done the cooking. You
okay,
do the wine.
Fair enough. Okay.
Wait a minute. Who did the pigs in blankets?
Oh, all right.
Thank you, Naomi,
out
for the girl.
For recognising my skill. So we have a white wine, as you can see, Dornhof Riesling Cabinet. So a nice, full-flavoured German Riesling. So this meat is rich, it's gamey, it's quite fatty. So I've chosen something with great acidity, refreshing, cut through that richness. It's got a bit of body, but lovely, refreshing.
It's going down awfully well, I can tell you.
That skin.
I'm going to get some skin on,
You've kept it beautifully moist.
I can't say anything, which is probably a relief, actually, for somebody
The wine is a bit of a revelation for me because I'm a traditionalist, a purist, and I would have served the red wine with that. It does work because of the fruit in the stuffing, because of the cranberry and the spice and the fruit in the roasted vegetables. It definitely works.
Right, we're ready for
that.
Look at that.
And no matter how much you've eaten, there's always room for a dessert. Mary's tort served with a sharp raspberry coulis.
So soft and smooth.
But it is the chocolate dessert over Christmas.
Whether your Christmas is steeped in tradition, entirely of your own creation, or cutting edge, what really matters is that it's indulgent, exciting, and fun. Happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas.
We're back in the new year for a new series of Food and Drink.
Oh, yeah.
I'm joined by some of the country's best loved cooks.
You are a genius.
It's a bit more original, too.
Chefs.
This whole meal probably costs around about £2 a head in total.
And foodies.
I love you, Michelle, you know.
Who share their favourite recipes and top tips.
Everybody in this country are also nervous about cooking rice. And this is a foolproof method.
This is the place to talk about food.
People don't become shopkeepers because they want to do a social service. They become shopkeepers because they want to make money.
And find out what we should be drinking.
It's what we call a face changer.
This is Food and Drink.
And tomorrow, stylish and seasonal. From tree decorating to festive lighting, she's got it all wrapped up. Alex Polizzi's Perfect Christmas is at 8. Now, 15th century fireworks and roast goose. It's Michaelmas on the Tudor Monastery Farm next. And in an hour, the Sarah Millican television programme Christmas Special here on BBC Two.